Hello, fellow readers. Hannah here, and today we're gonna do my January wrap up. So, January, first month of the year. Everyone's excited. We set our new reading goals, we get all into it, and this year, for maybe not the first time, but the first time in a while, I had an amazing reading month. The facts are that I was really excited to get into reading. I was super stoked for the new year and my new goals and everything. So, I read 12 books in January, which for me is pretty amazing. I'm trying to read 100 books this year, and I am ahead of my goal, so that makes me feel great, and can't wait to get into the February month. But before we can get into February, we've gotta wrap up this January. The first book that I read in January was Binti by Nnedi Okorafor. You've heard me talk about this in previous videos. This was the first book that I picked up this year, and it was the first book that I finished. It's 90 pages, so it wasn't that hard. But let me tell you, this is a novella about a girl named Binti who is 16 or 17. She decides she's been accepted to a prestigious university in the stars called Umza Uni, and she decides to spur her family's wishes and go and live in the stars and go to this university. She is what her village calls a master harmonizer, which is this ability to connect things, and her father was one. She was supposed to be one, but she wanted more for herself. And it is about her journey to Umza Uni, where it is attacked by an alien race and she has to fight to survive. This is a fantastic novella. I really loved it. It was a great start to the new year, and I gave it 5 out of 5 stars. Next up, and a theme that you will see for January, is audiobooks. I read a ton of audiobooks in January, and they were some of the best books that I read this month. So first up, we have Not My Father's Son by Alan Cumming. So Alan Cumming, you may be familiar with, is a actor. He is Scottish? I think he's Scottish. So this is his memoir, mostly covering his relationship with his father and some issues that he had. This was actually a pretty difficult book to read at parts because Alan Cumming's father was abusive to him and his brother, both mentally, verbally, and physically. So he had a difficult childhood, and this is him flipping back between memories from that childhood and as an adult dealing with some relevant information about his father. Alan Cumming narrates the audiobook, and his voice is just, it's magical to say the least. I really enjoyed listening to him tell these stories. It's like sitting down with an old friend who's telling you all about his life, the good, the bad, and everything in between, but being really honest. It was heart-wrenching, but it was also a really great memoir. For that reason, I gave Not My Father's Son by Alan Cumming 4 out of 5 stars. Then I finished a book that I started in December, and that was The Unleashing by Shelley Laurenston. If you follow me on Instagram, which I will leave the link down below, at Dark and Twisty Books, you will have seen this book many, many times. It was also a lot on my Litzy, which is also down below. I was reading this for a really long time. Now, it's a longer book. It's almost 400 pages. It just took me a while to get through this story. This follows Kira. She is a former Marine who, at the beginning of the story, is stabbed and killed. Fortunately for her, she had an admirer in Vig. He is a giant Viking type. He convinces Skuld, one of the Norse gods, to take Kira in and make her one of her crows. So Skuld works for the Norse gods and is a warrior, and she has her own group of warriors named the Crows who use rage and anger to fight. And Kira joins with the only caveat that her dog be able to join as well. I did enjoy this story. It was very different than what what I had read previously in romance novels. The main character is, I believe, half Filipino, and many of the characters in The House and in The Crows are also people of color. So that was really refreshing. Also, seeing women in power channeling their rage was also something that you don't see in books very often. Now, with that being said, there were some major issues in this. When Kira first goes to the house, there is a lot of infighting and cattiness between her and the other women in the house, which felt very stereotypical and very tired. Also, I found parts of the story to be less interesting than others, but I will say I might continue with this series because the second book follows a character that I really was intrigued by in this book, but we'll see. I gave The Unleashing by Shelley Laurenston 3 out of 5 stars. Then I picked up Binti Home by Nnedi Okorafor. This is the second book in the Binti trilogy. This continues the story of Binti after the first novella. Can't really go into a whole lot without spoiling the first one, but it continues on. I didn't love it as much as I loved the first novella, but I did enjoy it a lot, and I gave this one 4 out of 5 stars. Then another audiobook that I listened to was This Is Just My Face, Try Not to Stare by Gabourey Sidibe. I spent a lot of time listening to audiobooks by celebrities that were memoirs or something like that, and this is no exception. Gabourey Sidibe is an actress. She got her starring role in Precious, which is based on a novel pushed by Sapphire, and it was a huge hit when it came out, about a girl who is abused at home by her mother and father and gets pregnant and the difficulties of that life. Gabourey Sidibe is such an interesting person. She talks in this about what it was like to play a role where people confuse her with her character. To this day, she is confronted by people who think of her as Precious, and the complexities that come with playing a character that is abused and damaged, and when you yourself are not. She also covers her complicated relationship with her father. He is Senegalese, and his relationship with her mother is very complicated and fraught. So I really enjoyed this. Gabourey does a great job of telling you about her life, but not making it a sob story, but rather a tale of triumph and overcoming odds, not necessarily adversity, but, you know, difficulties that we all face in our lifetime. So I gave This Is Just My Face, Try Not to Stare by Gabourey Sidibe 4 stars. Then I picked up another audiobook, surprise, surprise, that is The Fire Next Time by James Baldwin. This is two letters that Baldwin wrote around the centennial of the Emancipation Proclamation, and it is talking about race and this country and the things that need to change in order for us to deal with race in a way that moves us forward. What's interesting is these essays were written in the 60s or 70s, and they feel as relevant today as they probably did then. Race and the way that we deal with it and the way that we ignore it, especially white people, is something that we're still dealing with today. So it is incredibly relevant. And so I gave The Fire Next Time 4 stars. Then I picked up another audiobook. Getting that audiobook action. Oh yeah. I worked a lot this month, so I was listening to tons of audiobooks, but they were awesome. So I picked up A Closed and Common Orbit by Becky Chambers. This is the second standalone novel in her Wayfarers series. The first is The Long Way to Small Angry Planet. I loved that book. I found the characters intriguing and fantastic. This book follows two minor characters from that novel and their adventures as they continue on in this world. I can't really give much more away without giving some things away. away. But suffice it to say that the character building really shines in this series. Becky Chambers is a master at making you see the complexities of a character and the intricacies of relationships. In this novel, she ties beautifully together the two stories, weaving them seamlessly in and out in a way that you see parallels between what it means to be human and what it means to be alive in general. I gave Closed and Common Orbit 4 stars. Then back to the real books. Not real. That's a little rude. Back onto the physical books. The next one that I picked up was The Changeling by Victor Lavelle. So this follows Apollo. He is a used and rare bookseller. He marries this woman that he falls in love with. She's a librarian. Her name is Emma. And they proceed to have a beautiful baby boy. But when Emma starts to doubt whether Brian is really their son, things get complicated and you have one parent versus another. This is obviously based on the changeling myth, but oh man, this story. So the first thing I'll say is that this story excellently captures what it is to be a book lover and to fall in love with books and reading. The first part is a lot about Apollo growing up and how he fell into love with books and how he got his job as a rare and used bookseller. But then there are the complexities of what it means to be a parent in the current day. Where do you draw the line between technology and sharing with the world and being proud of your child and holding things in and having privacy for yourself and your family? Victor Lavelle really explores these issues in an interesting way, and it's just excellent. I gave The Changeling by Victor Lavelle 4 stars. Then I picked up We're Going to Need More Wine Stories by Gabrielle Union. I did this on audio, and like I said, I just got really into the celebrity memoirs and stories from people being told by themselves, and this is no exception. Gabrielle Union is an actress in Hollywood. She's most known for her roles in Bring It On and Being Mary Jane. I didn't know a whole lot about Gabrielle Union's personal life and her rise to fame. So trigger warnings for this novel. She talks about when she was raped. I was talking about this book to my brother and he goes, "Do they cover the rape in the book?" And I was like, "How do you know about her rape?" And he said, "Well, you told me when we were like kids." So I must have read an article or something when I was young about her and about her survival of this horrific rape, but totally forgot about it. So this is the story of her growing up and moving from Omaha, Nebraska to California. It is about her relationships and trying to navigate who she was as a person. It's about her career. It's about her family. It's about her relationships. This is a very real accounting of Gabrielle Union's life. It is like sitting down with a friend and listening to stories and talking about big picture issues. It's not just a fluff piece. Gabrielle Union talks about colorism and racism and teaching her stepsons how to deal with the police. She does a great job of weaving gossipy bits and things that you didn't know or wanted to know, and other parts where it really makes you stop and think about what this country is and how we navigate this world that we live in. I gave We're Going to Need More Wine by Gabrielle Union 4 stars. Then I picked up Manhattan Beach by Jennifer Egan. This was the pick for my In Real Life book club. This is the story of Anna Kerrigan. She is a diver in a naval yard, but it follows her from her childhood and her relationship with her father, his relationship with a man named Dexter Stiles, and how those relationships intertwine and become confused and convoluted in adulthood. Basically, Anna runs back into Dexter Stiles. Her father has left their family and just gone away, and she's dealing with that, and she's dealing with being a woman in World War II, working and dealing with class and gender. And I will say, the writing in this was very good, and the characters were really interesting. However, I found that I didn't necessarily care about what was happening to the characters. Not to say that Jennifer Egan doesn't give stakes to this, I just found that the story was okay. It felt a little predictable, it felt a little like something that I had seen before, and so I wasn't exactly like grasping to get to the end of this story. I will say that her discussions of gender and what it's like being a woman during World War II were very interesting. The relationship between the father and the daughter was interesting as well, but overall, I just found it kind of okay, and that's why I gave Manhattan Beach 3 stars. Then finally, I have the books that I read for the 24 in 48 readathon. I will just interject here for a moment. I have a reading vlog from the 24 in 48 readathon. It should have come up last week, but unfortunately, I screwed up with the files. They didn't get corrupted, thank God, but all of the editing that I did is for naught, and I have to re-edit the entire thing. So I will say, I'm going to be working on that this week, and as soon as it's done, you'll get it, but I'm going to do it as a bonus video either this week or next week. It'll just go up when I'm done with it because it's a lot of editing, but I'm excited to show you my first reading vlog. With that being said, I read Binti, The Night Masquerade by Nnedi Okorafor. No surprise here, I couldn't wait to pick a third book in this trilogy. This continues the story yet again of Binti, and it was great. I really enjoyed this one. I actually enjoyed this one more than the second one. It still wasn't maybe as good as the first, but I mean, I think part of that is that excitement that you get from a first novel or novella. But this series is great. It talks about inclusion and feeling like an outsider and what it means for different species and races. It's so, so good and worth a read. This is the longest of the three. It's 200 pages, so it's not a very long series. I gave Binti, The Night Masquerade by Nnedi Okorafor, 4 stars. Last but not least, the final book that I finished in January was Monstrous Volume 1 by Marjorie Liu and Sana Takata. This is a graphic novel. Our main character is Micah, and she is a woman in a fantasy world where there are humans and there are Arcana. Arcana are sort of a mix between humans and animals, and Micah is sort of in between. She is not fully human, but she is also not part animal. This follows her journey in captivity in the beginning, and she escapes, and she's trying to find out what happened to her mother. This was a beautifully drawn series, and the characters were really interesting. It took me a while to get into this one, and I'm not sure whether or not I want to continue. It has some Lovecraftian vibes, which I did enjoy, and I am curious as to where the story is going to go, but overall, I wasn't as captivated as I had hoped to be, so I gave Monstrous 3 stars. So, those are the books that I read in January. I am in the middle of some. I mentioned in my book haul, I'm currently reading The Woman in the Window by AJ Finn. I started that during the 24 and 48 readathon. I read some stories in Canto Bight, but I have not finished any of those, so that is a story for another time. That is it for me. I will see you next time, and until then, stay twisty.